Everyone, my name is Ellina Abovian, and welcome to my hometown of Glendale. I'm a proud Armenian-American, and it is my privilege to present to you another year of this special program honoring Armenian-American community members here in the city of Los Angeles. Where I'm standing now is Central Park here in the heart of Glendale. It is the site of the future Armenian-American History Museum and Cultural Center of California. In 2021, I had the pleasure of hosting the groundbreaking ceremony, and in just a few short years, we will celebrate its grand opening. This has been a dream in the community for decades. The vision is to create a cultural campus where visitors can learn about the heritage, culture, and rich history of the Armenian people, which goes back thousands of years. More than 50,000 square feet, this space will house exhibitions, an auditorium for lectures and screenings, and a demonstration kitchen where visitors can learn and sample Armenian food. The mission is to bring people together, because only through learning can we appreciate our ethnic and cultural diversity. The city of Glendale was chosen as the location for this museum because, after all, Glendale is home to the largest Armenian-American population in the United States. Over the years, the community has done so much to reconfigure this once homogeneous, sleepy, sundown town of the 1950s into what it is today, an ethnically diverse and economically booming urban center. Among the first Armenians to settle in Glendale were members of the Jamukchan family, dating back to 1911. Avadis Jamukchan was heavily involved in the Near East Relief Committee, established in 1915 to give humanitarian aid to survivors of the genocide. Every April 24, Armenians around the world commemorate this somber day, the first Holocaust of the 21st century, remembering the 1.5 million people who lost their lives. Our first story is about a woman who not only survived the genocide, she became the face of the cause.
They should have punished these Turks before, right after the World War I, to bring to the justice and punish them. Otherwise, if they did punished, we wouldn't have had the massacre of the Jews.
This is Aurora's Sunrise, an animated film about Aurora Mardiganian, a true story of how a 14-year-old girl escaped death during the Armenian genocide, fled to New York, and became a silent film star.
The Aurora story was one of the rare ones.
Anna Sahakian directed the film. Through the dynamic combination of mediums, animation, archival interviews with Aurora herself, and digitally restored footage, this forgotten story becomes vivid again. Sahakian explains it was in 2014, she was doing research for a different project at the Zorian Institute in Canada, when she stumbled upon Aurora's testimony, recorded in 1984 when Aurora was 83 years old.
Yeah, that serving coming that we took the sweetheart Andranik part. And that's me, Aurora.
Aurora is holding a poster for Auction of the Souls from 1919, a silent 20-minute film depicting the tragic events of the genocide. Aurora played herself, an orphan teenager forced into a death march through the Syrian desert, kidnapped, raped, and then sold into slavery. Through a series of miraculous events, she escaped and moved to New York when she was 17. She told her story to the newspapers and then on the silver screen, reliving the unthinkable trauma.
She did it only in order to help other orphans and that the story of Armenian suffering will be widely known in the world.
Auction of the Souls was a box office hit, and Aurora, the most unlikely starlet of the silent film era in Hollywood. She also became the face of the aid group Near East Relief, which raised $116 million back then and rescued more than 132,000 orphaned survivors just like Aurora. Unfortunately, it was all short-lived. Following World War I, expanding U.S. and Turkish relations caused any mention of the genocide to fade away, and most copies of Auction of the Souls disappeared. Only in 1994, months after Aurora's death, fragments were discovered. Sahakian is one of few filmmakers to bring it all back to life.
Because it was not fair that her story was forgotten. And it's not forgotten only now, it was forgotten also while she was alive.
Going beyond the cold facts of the genocide, Sahakian beautifully and uniquely tells the story of not a victim, but a survivor. Aurora's Sunrise premiered at Annecy in 2022, receiving rave reviews and accolades from film festivals around the world.
I really think that we need to have strong stories and strong role models from the past. We always hear these victim stories, and it's not really giving us strength to move on with our legacy and with our pain.
Since the release of Auction of the Souls, few films have been made about the Armenian genocide. Some examples, The Promise, Mayrik, and Ararat. Producing a film around this topic has always been a challenge, largely due to pushback from the Turkish government and its quest to control the historical narrative. Turkey denies the genocide ever happened. The most famous incident goes back to the 1930s. MGM Studios secured the rights to produce the film 40 Days of Musaddal, based on the novel by Austrian Jewish writer Franz Werfel. Pre-production began in 1934. Clark Gable was even set to be the star. However, Hollywood, due to pressure from the Turkish government, abandoned the project. The novel, originally written as a warning against Hitler and the Holocaust through the prism of the Armenian genocide. Ironically, Armenian-Americans have had a lot of success in Hollywood, from actors to writers to producers. Next up is the story of Steve Papazian, a man who started in the Warner Brothers mailroom during Hollywood's golden era. He went on to make more movies than anyone can count.
I think this is that really sweet actor. What's his name? Greg?
Kinnear.
Kinnear. That's yeah. Greg. Look how young he is.
A Day with Steve Papazian is a trip down movie memory lane. He's Hollywood royalty, and looking around his home office, it's an homage to his legacy. ...570 movies under his tutelage as president of production for Warner Brothers Studios, a career he launched in the 60s. It all started his senior year at CSUN. Papazian worked as a tour guide for Universal. Then, like his dad, he joined the Navy and was drafted during the Vietnam War.
And when I got out, my dad said, come on, work with us. He had a market and a deli and a restaurant and that kind of thing. And I said, nah, it's not going to be for me. I want to be in showbiz.
It was 1968, the Warner Brothers mailroom, a time when Hollywood felt more like a family.
There wasn't as much separation, so a grip could be a friend of an actor.
That actor for him was then movie star Robert Mitchum, who invited Papazian on an unforgettable trip to Mazatlan.
Here's this gigantic yacht in the harbor, and there's John Wayne, drink in his hand and a cigarette here, and we played gin, and I played really well. Took some money from John Wayne, much to his dismay.
They played hard and they worked hard. Papazian was drawn to the business side, first in TV for shows like Growing Pains and Night Court. Then came the chance to make movies.
I've been waiting my life for that.
He became the money guy, the guy who could say no, and he did it with grace, balancing art with commerce. Having greenlit movies like The Matrix and Harry Potter, he was a whiz on the logistics side.
I had a chance to work with Chris Nolan, Clint Eastwood.
Papazian wasn't born into the biz, but he was destined for it, inspired early on while growing up in North Hollywood.
As a little boy, Sherry Sarkisian lived down the street, and she became Cher.
And just like Cher, Papazian is an Armenian too. The son of Jerry Papazian and Virginia Albarian, whose families immigrated to the States right before the genocide.
They knew times were changing and it was not going to be very kind to Christianity in the neighborhood.
A few summers ago, Papazian took the trip of a lifetime. He went to Armenia for the first time.
I went there to honor my parents, grandparents. Look at the sacrifices.
The family he was born into and the family he created is what Papazian is most proud of. A fruitful life, a success story, fit for the big screen.
And this is the stuff we used to do. You don't get to do that stuff, I don't think, quite as much as these days.
Meeting and interviewing Steve Papazian was such a treat. I asked him what advice he would give to the younger generation, and he said, whatever job you have, just do it really, really well. Be the best at it, and the right person will notice. Coming up next, we'll introduce you to someone else who's really good at their job, the man in charge of running the LA Football Club. Looking around the landscape of professional sports, you will see Armenians thriving in many and varied corners. Andre Agassi, one of the most iconic tennis players of all time, is of Armenian heritage, as is David Nalbandian. And if you're a fan of college basketball, you'll surely recognize the name Jerry Tarkanian, aka Tark the Shark, one of the most celebrated coaches. Up next is the story of former pro soccer player John Thorington, who has all the components of a successful Armenian, minus the last name.
We feel how good it is to be champions, so we want to work for get more.
LA has a new culture, the LA Football Club. The man at the helm of it, co-president and general manager John Thorington.
I love absolutely every sport. I have what many people call as a sickness when it comes to competing. But at the age of 12, 13, 14, soccer became the one I was best at, most likely to win.
John was born in Johannesburg, South Africa. In the early 80s, the family moved across the globe to California, to Palos Verdes, where John went to Chadwick School, and played soccer for the Mission Viejo Pateadores. At 17, he signed with Manchester United and went pro. He played abroad and in the U.S. until retiring at 25. In 2015, he joined the LAFC, except there wasn't much to work with. No uniforms, no stadium, not even an office. Flash forward to 2022, he assembled the dream team.
So with that, I would like to welcome Gareth Bale.
Can win MLS Cup for LAFC. Yes!
Good at the players, the staff, dug deep, made it happen to deliver this cup. MLS Cup just felt like this culmination of years and years of hard work, of smart, dedicated, focused people that wanted to bring a championship to LA.
A victory both professional and personal for John. At every game, the red, blue, and orange flags represent his Armenian heritage very few people know about.
It catches people off guard, and people are always surprised to hear that I am half Armenian and more Armenian than anything else, and it's certainly something I identify with very strongly. The resourcefulness, the care, and the having of each other's back, I think that's of utmost importance as human beings, and I think that's really represented by Armenians in a very visible and tangible way.
The Los Armenios is the Armenian fan club, but the best thing about this club is that it brings all kinds of people together.
I was at an event after the championship, and we were celebrating, and I overheard an introduction of, my name is Ara, and I said, you must be Armenian, and this gentleman says, yes, why are you asking me this? And I said, I'm Armenian, and he's sort of like, what are you talking, you know, very, very taken aback.
Ara is also the name of John's second daughter, which in Armenian means king.
The way this all came together, for soccer to be the thing that brought me back after 20 years elsewhere, it just felt like the stars aligned.
You deserve it! You guys deserve it! Let's go!
In the 1920s, there were 3,000 Armenians in the city of LA. Today, there are more than 200,000. Here in Southern California, the city of Montebello was one of the first suburbs most Armenians migrated to in the 1930s. The people who settled in Montebello were escaping the Soviet Union during World War II. According to the USC Institute of Armenian Studies, 20 million Soviet citizens died during World War II. 200,000 were Armenian. Among those who escaped, about 4,000 people found themselves in Stuttgart, Germany, relocated into labor camps, many of them seeking refuge from Stalin's regime. By 1952, thousands of these Armenians were able to immigrate to the United States, thanks to a special act of Congress called the Displaced Persons Act. Over the last century, the Armenian migration happened in several significant waves. Slowly but surely, we established communities here, schools and churches.
At first glance, Chameleon Day School in Glendale seems like the perfect bubble, but it's so much more than that. It's one of 13 Armenian day schools in LA, created for the sole purpose of preserving what is most sacred to them, their language and identity.
Our parents, our grandparents, our great-grandparents, they experienced all this intergenerational trauma from the genocide, and creating schools and churches and these cultural centers, like creating Chameleon for them was an opportunity to reclaim what was stolen.
The trauma, the fear, and the deep betrayal Armenians felt after the genocide carried on for decades. Survivors spread to different parts of the world. Some changed their last names as they assimilated to their newfound cities and countries. Here in LA, for nearly 50 years after, a generation was lost without a real connection to their culture. It wasn't until Holy Martyrs Ferayan School opened in Encino in 1964, the first local Armenian school. Then came Mesropian in Pico Rivera and Pilibos in Hollywood, giving new hope to a community desperate for a voice.
Accessing opportunities only available in the United States while providing that anchor in cultural and heritage work, passing on their legacy to the next generation of Armenians.
As a people historically persecuted for their religion and ethnicity, Armenians in LA were finally free to flourish. Throughout the 80s, 70s, and so on, they built countless stores, bakeries, restaurants, fast food chains, churches, and cultural centers. AGBU is one of them, established more than a century ago to give back to the community and to Armenia.
With all of the new generations coming, whether it's through scouting, whether it's through cultural Armenian dance or innovative programs, there's always an Armenian element for the youth to learn on, for the choir to sing about, for everyone to come together and really embrace our culture and not forget where we came from.
With a strong sense of self, it's up to the future generations to serve as the torchbearers for the Armenian cause. They know if they don't fight for their heritage and homeland, no one else will. A harsh realization for Armenians during the 44-day Artsakh War, and now with the blockade.
The government of Azerbaijan has blockaded the Republic of Artsakh.
They have blocked the Latin Corridor, which is the only road that connects Artsakh to the Republic of Armenia.
This road is a lifeline for 120,000 citizens.
And because of its geographical location, the future of Armenians in the region is still in jeopardy today, and might always be.
Then we will empower our students with the confidence and the character to grow into better global citizens of the world who will defend justice against inhumanities anywhere in the world.
Most importantly, we teach our children and the younger generation that we are not a nation of victims. Our ancestors survived so that we could plant seeds and flourish wherever we end up. Coming up next is a great example of that. Four best friends who started a business in Hollywood, but now have a global brand. Are the guys behind the famous Dave's Hot Chicken. It started as a simple idea amongst four friends, and it is now a global brand.
A bunch of people have been talking about this place.
We got one in mild and we got one in really, really high.
Or if you're brave enough, try the Reaper. One juicy bite at a time, Dave's Hot Chicken has taken the world by storm. It all began in Hollywood in 2017 with four best friends, Tommy and Gary Rubenian, Dave Kapushian, and Armin Oganessian.
I remember me and Dave having a talk, and I was like, look, dude, you've been doing culinary your whole life. I mean, you work at all these French restaurants. I'm sure cooking fried chicken isn't going to be that difficult.
Armin and Dave came up with the initial idea. Dave at the time was an up-and-coming chef formerly trained at French Laundry.
I was doing stand-up comedy and acting, which obviously doesn't pay much at all. I think Tommy at the time was unemployed, so we definitely felt like it's do or die, and we were like, we have to do something, and we have to try, and we have to like really go for it.
Once they had the recipe down, they scraped up $900, all the money they had, and decided to do a pop-up in a parking lot on the corner of Hollywood and Normandy. Just the tent, a grill, and furniture they brought from home.
We just started serving. You know, we were just screaming to people passing by, we have chicken, and then we posted on social media, and you know, we were just doing anything and everything we can to get attention to the food.
They created a social media buzz and got the attention of a writer from Eater LA. The next morning's headline read, East Hollywood Late Night Chicken Stand Might Blow Your Mind.
We got to the pop-up that day and there was like 95 people standing in line waiting for us. And we had a fryer that would make like 4 orders every 20 minutes. So we were like, oh man, we're gonna be here a while today. So ever since then, it's just been really crazy and the lines have kind of never stopped.
Outside every Dave's Hot Chicken, there's a crowd. A year later, the guys opened their first brick and mortar in Hollywood on Western. For Angelinos, their food became an addiction.
Right here, look at that.
9 out of 10 for the fry.
Pretty soon, they had a line of investors too, including rapper Drake, Samuel L. Jackson, and Boston Red Sox chairman Tom Werner.
We actually got a call from a man named John Davis, who was one of the investors of Blaze Pizza, one of the investors of Wetzel's Pretzels.
Dave's Hot Chicken now has hundreds of employees in more than 120 locations with a commitment to open more than 780 locations worldwide. The secret to their sauce? Stay humble and stay hungry.
It's definitely life-changing, just the way people look at you and like to the parents and how proud parents are. When we started the company, we had a plan of doing the pop-up for a year and then, you know, doing a food truck for 2 years, and then within the third year having a store, 4 or 5 years, you have 120 open. You're just almost blown away by it.
I just can't believe this meal right now.
Armenian inventors that changed the world. Alex Manoogian is credited with making the first Delta faucet in 1965. Gabriel Kazanjian, the first hairdryer in 1911. Hovhannes Adamyan invented the color television in 1808. Christopher Dersaropian, the color of the U.S. dollar in 1854. Luther George Simijian, the ATM in 1960. And this is just a fraction of the list. There is not a field in which Armenian men and women don't succeed, because it's embedded in our DNA. We not only survive, but we thrive, and we are just getting started. Thank you for joining us. I'm Lena Abovian.